bless you this morning. Isn't the Lord wonderful? Do you have some more praise you would like to give to Him right now? Would you like to reach into the depths of your soul? Lift your hands and lift your voice and give Him great praise. Hallelujah. Are certainly blessed to be in the presence of the Lord today, and we're grateful for the privilege and the opportunity to be right here at First Pentecostal Church, Durham, North Carolina. Amen. And I just want to join with you for the service this morning and the service this evening, and trust that the Lord is going to do a great work in us, among us. Amen. A work that'll help us today, but a work that'll continue tomorrow. How many came hungry for the word of the Lord? Praise God. I want to say how much I respect and appreciate the pastor of this congregation. I want to give great honor to Pastor Urshan and give him honor for the work of what he is doing and who he is. And I know that you consider yourself blessed to have this great man as pastor of this local assembly. Give honor to his wonderful wife and his extended family. And we're just glad to be here. I'd like for you to open your Bibles with me to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. We're going to read 3 verses of scripture from this chapter. Going to read verses 9, 10, and 11. And I also, while you're turning, want to give honor to Bishop Johnny Godare. It's great to see you. Love and appreciate you very much. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9, 10, and 11. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you, but ye are washed, but ye are sanctified, but ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. How many is glad you've been washed, sanctified, and justified in the name of the Lord Jesus? And if you are not washed, sanctified, and justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God, you can experience that before this service is over. He is washing still today. He is sanctifying still today. And He is justifying. In the name of Jesus, through water baptism and through the Spirit by the infilling of the Holy Ghost. If you've never experienced that, I encourage you to open your heart right now to the moving and the working of the presence of God and the preached word of God, and let God do His wonder work in your life. Why don't we just praise God for His great salvation today? Jesus, we love you. Jesus, we praise you. Jesus, we exalt you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you right now for your presence. For the power of your word, the power of your truth. God bless you. You may be seated. When the United States made the Louisiana Purchase in 1803, There was confusion and contention over where the official borderline was in Spanish Texas. And it had been an issue between the French and the Spanish prior to the United States acquisition of those Louisiana territories. But the new purchase made by the United States required that now the Spanish and the leaders of the United States would come together, negotiate, and come to a mutual agreement concerning where the boundary would be between Louisiana and Texas. And so when Louisiana made the initial purchase, they chose to accept, for a while at least, the agreement that had been made between the French and the Spanish. And that the French and the Spanish had created what we would call a buffer zone between two parcels of land. And the governments agreed that they would remove all troops from that disputed area, leaving the area without any governing authorities. We have a brother from South Korea here today. It would be somewhat like the DMZ between South Korea and North Korea. And the United States, when they made the Louisiana Purchase, they kept the buffer zone from 1803 until 1819. That neutral territory, that neutral strip of land between Louisiana and Texas was some 200 miles long from north to south. And it went from 30 to 60 plus miles wide. I'm letting you know that because it was really a large area. 200 miles long north and south and 30 to 60 plus miles wide in different areas. In the early days, Native Americans, Scotch-Irish pioneers, and African Americans settled there. A family would go, they would build themselves a house, they would take a few acres in, plant a garden. They just wanted to live independently, be alone. They weren't interested in establishing plantations in this area. They were just wanting to survive and thrive. They wanted to be alone and they wanted to be left alone. And so for many years, they would just have a small house, plant a garden, maybe erect a steel. As a matter of fact, this is what I'm going to preach with the help of the Lord this morning. Daddy was a moonshiner. So the first settlers, Native Americans, Scotch-Irish, African Americans, went into that area. They just wanted to live, be alone, live alone, be independent, raise families. But once this area was established as a buffer zone between the eastern border for Louisiana and the western border for Texas, it became a drawing place of the lawless. And it began to be a place that would be inhabited by the worst of the worst. It became a precursor to the Wild West. And literally, if you look it up, you can do that today. It became known as no man's land. Every scoundrel, every rebel, every renegade, every robber resorted into that area. One of the most popular legends in that area in that time was John Muro. He was infamously known as the Reverend Devil. His father was a preacher, and subsequently, he learned the Bible at a young age. And the legend is that he could quote all 10 commandments while he was breaking them. I mean, this area began to be infiltrated with smugglers and bandits and thieves, and anyone that was trying to push westward through that area would find themselves vulnerable. There was cattle rustlers, there was pirates. Jean Lafitte operated in that area. I mean, and it was, we would consider him lawless, but he wasn't lawless, there was no law. So he could operate freely. He could just do anything he wanted. And they liked it because he was bringing goods in now. Not everything was good, but gunpowder, things like that. No. Even later into this area, the notorious bandits and Bonnie and Clyde outlaws came through that area. I'm just saying that land was rough and rugged. That's where I was brought up. That's the area that my mom and dad was born and raised in. That's the area where their mother and dad was raised. My grandfathers, my grandmothers were born and raised in no man's land. My mother and father, before their conversion, were perfect examples of people that were brought up in that area. They said if you was to look at the word country in the dictionary, if you still have a dictionary, it would be my dad's picture next to it. My dad's a tall guy, 6'2", weighs 220 pounds, and he's been that size since he was 15 years old. And so my mom and dad together were a mix of Native American and Scot-Irish. My mother was more Native American. My dad's side, the Townleys, were Scot-Irish. And my dad knew how to fight. I remember visiting my grandparents, my great-grandparents, actually, when I was a boy. We'd pull up to their house. It was a small house. There was a small barn next to the house. There was an old truck. There was a couple of cows. There was a few chickens. There was a large garden. And sitting on the back porch, shelling purple hull peas, was my grandparents. If they weren't on the back porch handling the vegetables that come out of their garden, they were on the front porch chewing tobacco, dipping their snuff, and seeing who could spit the furthest. And grandma would win. Grandma was bad. I'm telling you, this is Little Ma. Little Ma was a squirrel hunter. She went squirrel hunting into her 90s. She hunted with a .22 rifle until her 80s. She would kill as many as 100 squirrels a year. And she stopped using a .22 rifle in her 80s because her vision got so bad. She resorted to a .410 shotgun. I wished I could tell you that that's the things that I would know about guns and just hunting. But I remember Big Ma. This was Little Ma's daughter. We called her Big Ma, which was my actual grandmother, my mother's mother. I remember going to visit her one day, and when I got there, she wasn't feeling well. She was weak. Before it was over, she had told my mom that her lover had just shot her. She pulled up her shirt, and there was pellets all in her back where grandma had been shot. No one called the law, but they had law then, all right, by this time. No one called the law. Nothing happened. I look back on that now, I'm like, what? What kind of thought process? People really live like that. I know you might find this surprising, but it was so country. When I was a boy, I'm not old, all right? I'm 51 years old. It's hard to believe that I went to a church that our restroom was out in a little house over there. No running water in the church where my parents prayed through and received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. They told me as a boy that there was bears, and there are black bears in Louisiana. They didn't have a problem with me going to the restroom when I was growing up. A little outhouse out there. I'm just giving you an idea of where I came from. God's been good to the Townley family. My Papa Albert, on my dad's side, raised sugar cane, and he, turned it into syrup every year. Always loved being a part of that. He always found a way to keep some of it. He'd have cane beer. All my life, we'd go there. There'd be cane beer on the porch. I promise I never tasted it, but my dad told me it was horrible. Dad said, don't let anybody tell you anything. It's all bad. It don't taste good at all. And then I thought about my mom. My mom and dad raised me in the church. When I was 2 years old, my mom and dad received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. My mom was bound to nicotine. She smoked more than 3 packs of cigarettes a day. The last time my mother drank, she drank a pint of White Lightning. My mom and dad didn't tell me much when I was growing up about their background. They didn't want us to know it. Again, at 2 years old, they brought us into the church. All I know about my mom and dad is that they loved God. They served God. They were faithful saints. They were prayer warriors. They were involved. They were engaged. Anything that was happening at the church, the Townley family were going to be there. If it was worship, we'd be there. If it was work, we'd be there. If it was witnessing, we would be there. My mom and dad taught Bible studies, won many souls to the Lord. My mother passed away 12 years ago at 64 years of age. We did a quick count when she passed away of the souls that they had won to the Lord. There was more than 40 people that they had won to the Lord. What I'm telling you is my parents didn't look like what they had been through. The James and Diane Townley that I knew was far from the ones that grew up in no man's land. All I knew is that they loved God. They served God. They were faithful to the work of God. They were engaged in the expansion of the kingdom and the salvation of souls. They wouldn't tell us many stories. Dad would tell us some. My dad's a Vietnam vet. He would share us some stories with us. But after Mom passed away, my brother got with my dad and said, Dad, would you please? I know Mom told me that she would hope that we would never know her prior life. But would you tell me? He said, Son, when your mother was conceived in the womb, her father believed that he actually wasn't the father. He was made to believe he was, but Mom had been sleeping around. Your mother was rejected before she was ever born. After she was born, she became physically abused. The man would literally beat her. There was times he'd get so angry, he'd stick a gun at her head. He would torment her. He would shoot at her feet and make her dance. This is the environment. No man's land. Mean. There come a day after she was a teenager, he beat her so bad, she left home and said, I'll never be back. And he said, Son, I want you to know, think of the wildest woman you know, and your mother was wilder. There's no way to imagine. I would have never thought it. I would have never known it. All I knew is I had a mother that had a mothering spirit. All I know is I had a mother that had a good attitude. All I knew is that I had a mother that knew how to mother sons. I had a mother that loved to pray, be a part of ladies' prayer meetings, teach Bible studies, love God. She didn't look like what she had been through. She'd been through the fire, but she didn't smell like smoke. God had taken it all out of her spirit. I'm here to preach hope to you today. I don't know what you've been through. I don't know what you've dealt. I don't know the pain in your spirit. I don't know the sorrow in your soul, but I'm here to tell you there's hope in the Lord Jesus Christ. You've been wanting a changed and transformed life. You can have it today. If you've prayed the prayer and said, God, I don't want my children to be raised like I was raised, God will help you and give you grace. Amen. There's an apostolic preacher preaching to you today and giving you hope because there was a man and a lady that God was gracious to, forgave them of their sins, washed him in his blood, and gave them the glorious gift of the Holy Ghost. There's hope for you today in the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I remember right after my dad received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. I don't remember it. I remember him telling me, all right? Right after my dad received the baptism of the Holy Ghost, he walked into his pastor's office and he said, Pastor, I need to ask you something. He said, there's a man that stole some things from me. And I know who did it. Remember, my dad's Irish. He didn't pick a fight, but he wouldn't run from one either. And he was like, I want to tell this man. I want to show up at his house and tell him, you bring back my goods or I'm going to whoop you. That's the way he would say it. Not with a belt. And so he said, but I don't threaten. If I say it, I'm going to do it. And I'm not going to give him a threat. I'm going to tell him what I'm going to do. He either brings back what he's stolen or I will take care of him. The pastor looked and said, Jim, you can't do that. You just got the Holy Ghost, man. You just got in the church. You don't fight anymore. I know you used to run bars and you used to fight. And you had your own steel. You drank your own moonshine. And you fought your own battles. Now's the time to put the fighting aside. He said, okay. He walks out the door of the pastor's office and he says, now, Holy Ghost, you better do your thing. And guess what? The Holy Ghost did its thing. He didn't fight. He was able to handle it right. I'm just trying to tell you, God can make changes and transformations in your life. He can take out the old and he can put in a new man, a new lady, give you a new way of walking, give you a new way of talking. Hallelujah. Amen. The Lord wanted me to come to Durham this Sunday morning and offer you hope. There's love, there's mercy, there's forgiveness, there's transformation, there's a new life in Jesus Christ. One more story. My dad said, back when he was younger, he'd be making that moonshine out there in the woods. There was a guy named Willie Fee that was the forester. They had a big old tower next to our house. He would watch for forest fires. It wasn't always forest fires, the smoke that was coming up. And there was a day that the FBI, literally, this is true, revenuers, what they would call it, the FBI climbed in the tower. He knew some moonshining was going on with Willie. and they saw Dad's smoke going up. Willie knew whose smoke it was too. So they tried to pinpoint the area. You know, Willie didn't want the FBI to find it, but so he was kind of holding some stuff back, and he'd give the general area where my dad was at. And while the forest truck was driving down the road trying to find where that smoke was, he was in the trees and couldn't see it. You could only see it from the tower. Dad said he had a good friend named Jonathan with him. He told Jonathan, I hear some noise. Go out there and see what's going on. Heard a vehicle passing close by. He said Jonathan came back and said, oh, it's just a wood truck over there. He said, come to find out, he hadn't even went all the way out to check anything out. He was just plastered and just went a little ways in the woods, came back and lied to him. Dad said, we heard that vehicle coming by. We grabbed our jugs and went off, took off running. Dad was ever grateful for the day when he put the moonshining behind him and started drinking the new wine of the Spirit. I can't tell you how many times they would have my dad to stand and testify. My dad would normally sit on the front row. They'd have him stand and testify. He couldn't get very far into his testimony before he'd start slapping his arm. Tears start rolling down his face. And he couldn't say any more, except I'm just thankful. I thank God for his mercy. Thank God for saving me. He could talk about all the accidents he was in, having been in Vietnam, how God spared, God saved him, and God secured him and allowed him to come home and be born again and be transformed by the blood and the Spirit of the Lord. And all he could do was just stand and weep and cry. Sometimes he would stand and nothing could come out of his mouth. Just tears flowing, thankful, grateful to be a new creature, to be filled with the Holy Ghost, saved. Hallelujah. The words to the song says, we've all done things that we're not proud of, made mistakes along the way, walked the path of least resistance, and traveled roads that led to shame. But there's no need to be held captive neath the weight that blame can bring. Just pour your heart to the Savior. He alone can break the chains. There is freedom and there's forgiveness. There is peace and sweet relief. Grace and mercy now are waiting when you bow at Jesus' feet. I wonder, as the musicians come this morning, if there's anybody in this building, or how many somebodies in this building would like to say, Lord, I'm tired of carrying the shame, the pain, the sins of my past. I want to become a new creature. If we was to just begin to name the sins like was mentioned right here in our text, we could talk about adultery. We could talk about fornication. We could talk about idolatry. We could talk about effeminacy. We could talk about people that abuse themselves with mankind. We could talk about thievery. We could talk about being covetous. We could talk about being drunkards. We could talk about being revilers, extortioners. We've all been there. We've all had our own sins. But we can all also experience forgiveness. Because it's not what you've done that ultimately matters. There's hope through the blood of Jesus Christ. And there is a washing that we can experience. I want to be washed in the blood of the Lamb. How about you? Anybody want to be washed clean in your heart, in your mind, in your spirit, and in your soul? Anybody want your sins purged and your heart purified? You can experience that today as we stand. You can experience it right here in this service today. You can be washed. You can be sanctified. You can be justified. You can be made clean from your sins. You can become holy by the infilling of the Holy Ghost and be presented as righteous, justified, just as if you had not sinned, righteous in the presence of the Lord. This is what Jesus does best. Save souls, transform lives, give people fresh opportunities and new beginnings. And today is one of those days. He's here. He's calling. He's inviting. He's wooing. He's beckoning. He's drawing. Let me wash you. Let me cleanse you. Let me give you what you want and what you desire. Let your past become your past. And that's the essence of what I'm preaching today. Daddy was in capital letter, was a moonshiner. Because it doesn't matter what the occupation, what the activity was. What matters is that he redeems us. He rescues us. He saves us. And he sanctifies. Anybody want to be saved today? Anybody want to be sanctified? While we begin to play and sing, while we pray and worship, would you like to come forward?
I need your mercy.
Would you like to repent of your sins? Would you like the Holy Ghost to do for you what the Holy Ghost does for everyone?
Leading the way.
Hallelujah.
Can make it without you.
Bow at Jesus' feet.
Not for one day.
Bow at Jesus' feet.
I need your mercy. And I need your grace. I need your mercy. I need your grace.
That's it. Let the blood work.
I need your hand.
Let the Spirit work.
Leading the way.
Let God save and sanctify.
Can't make it without you. Not for one day. I need your mercy. And I need your grace. I need your mercy. I need your grace.
That's it. Invite a friend. Invite a neighbor.
I need your hand leading the way. I can't make it without you. Not for one day. I need your mercy. And I need your grace. Well, I need your mercy.
The Holy Ghost is moving over people right now. Let the Holy Ghost touch your heart. Hallelujah. That's the Spirit of God moving over you. Somebody respond to His touch. Respond to the touch of the Lord. Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
I need your hand. Leading the way. Can't make it without you. Not for one day. I need your mercy.
I need your mercy. In the name of Jesus, the Holy Ghost is touching people right now. That's it. Lift your voice right where you're at. Lift your hands and ask God to have His way. In the name of Jesus.
I need your hand leading the way. I can't make it without you. Not for one day. I need your mercy. I need your grace. Yes, I need your mercy. And I need your grace. I need your hand leading the way. I can't make it without you. Well, not for one day. And I need your mercy. Yes, I need your grace. Lord, I need your mercy. And I need your grace. Your hand leading the way. I can't make it without you. Not for one day. And I need your mercy. I need your grace. Well, I need your mercy. Lord, I need your grace. I need your hand leading the way. I can't make it without you. Not for one day. I need your mercy.
To heaven.
I need your grace.
I need your hand. Heaven and ask God to be with us today. Let's give thanks unto the Lord for His goodness. Let's give thanks unto the Lord for His grace. Oh, blessed be the name of Jesus. Blessed be the name of Jesus. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise right now. Thank you, Jesus. The laundry list of sins are so, it's so long. There's so many. And if you look, you'll find yourself somewhere. You'll find the environment you came from. You can point to it and say that right there, that's what I was. But you don't have to stay that. Such were some of you. I don't have to be that anymore. You don't have to be that anymore. You are washed. You are sanctified. You are justified. How am I washed? How am I washed? The Bible says, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. How am I sanctified? How am I justified? The Bible says, by the Spirit of our God. That is to be baptized in Jesus' name and filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. The gospel of Jesus Christ is this: the death, the burial, and the resurrection. We're supposed to obey that gospel. In the letter to the Thessalonians, Paul told the church, he said the Lord's going to be revealed one day and his holy angels, and he's going to take vengeance on them that know not God and who obey not the gospel. How do I obey the gospel? How do I obey the death, burial, and resurrection? I obey the death when I repent. That's when you die. That's when you say, I don't want to be like that anymore. I'm getting rid of my moonshine. We went up to Boone for the men's conference, and I saw a restaurant out there. We were looking for restaurants, and one of it had alcoholic beverages, and they called it Boonshine. I said, I don't think I'm going to go to Boonshine. But I die to my sins. I die to what I was. I die to my self-will. All that sin and filth that hell wants to drag you down with. I die when I repent of my sins. And then I get buried in Jesus' name. And I obey the burial. I obey the burial. I want to be buried with Jesus in baptism. He was buried. I want to be buried. And then Paul told the church at Rome, he said, if you're buried with him, you'll be raised with him. Whew, I want to go to heaven with Jesus. I want a trumpet to sound, and I want to hear his voice when he calls his church away. That's the Holy Ghost. I obey the resurrection when I get the Holy Ghost. My Bible says that if the same Spirit that raised up Jesus lives in you, He'll raise you up.
He'll quicken your mortal body. That's the death, the burial, and the resurrection. If you've never repented, you can repent right now. If you've never been baptized, you can be buried with Jesus and be baptized right now. If you've never received the Holy Ghost, God will baptize you with the Holy Ghost. And I don't have to be a moonshiner. I don't have to be a liar. I don't have to be an extortioner. But God can make me a new creature. Praise God. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise this morning. Amen. Brother Newton, if you would come dismiss us with a word of prayer. Thank you, Brother Townley, for preaching to us this morning. Thank you for obeying the Holy Ghost. Service is tonight at 6 o'clock. Let's come ready to pray. God bless you.
Praise the Lord. Good preaching. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. I thank you, God. Hallelujah. And there's all these people here that are thanking God that he brought us out of that world, that brought us out of all that filthy mess that we was in. Hallelujah. I love this message. I said, I love this message. Hallelujah. Because when I repented, I baptized in Jesus' name. God filled me with the Holy Ghost 40-something years ago. Hallelujah. And I found a good life. I said, I found a good life, a clean life, and the many blessings that God has bestowed over all these years. Amen. And one day, this is the icing on the cake. We're going to get to go to heaven with Jesus. We're going to get to look upon his face. Hallelujah. Thank you, Brother Townley. Good preaching. Amen. Stirred the memories in my mind of where God had brought me from. And how good that God has been to me. Hallelujah. I thank God this morning for this Jesus name apostolic message. Praise God. Amen. Let's pray and be dismissed this morning. Amen. Lord, we thank you for your goodness and we thank you for your mercy. Thank you for the many, many blessings that you have sent our way, Lord. And we ask God that you would keep your hand upon us. Keep us safe, Lord. Bring us back to be with the people of God and to hear your word once again.